Well, thank you. As Frederik said, I'm Boudewijn. I'm the project lead of Krita, and I've been working on Krita since 2003. That's quite a long time. We've got a lot of history there, and part of the history of Krita is quite interesting because it sort of does show the way a free software project can grow and mature and change over time. I wanted to apologize. I didn't do a lot of work on the slides because it's been quite hard to type for the past 3 weeks. So, history. How many people knew about Gimp? K-I-M-P. This I probably have told you, and you were there, I guess. Way back in the prehistory, when people were still innocent and GTK was only the Gimp toolkit, people started working on this weird idea. Let's have an integrated, sophisticated Linux desktop system where all the applications use the same kind of conventions for GUIs. So what we had was KDE, Qt, and we had this painting application called Gimp, which stuck out and didn't look very good on the KDE desktop. So what happened? Someone wrote a patch, and a patch made Gimp use Qt and all the conventions. That led to a huge row. This patch should not have been written. It should not have been made public. People should not have talked about it. In answer, the response from KDE was, let's do our own GIMP clone. Let's do an application, and let's give it a really original name. We call it K-ImageShop, because that's for sure not going to give any problems. Our mailing list is still called K-ImageShop, but that's the last remnant of that name because, well, lawyers happened. So we had to rename the next name, Crayon. That's nice. It starts with a K. It has something to do with painting. We got lawyers. Finally, we renamed to Krita, and a couple of years later, the Krita.org domain name became available after the music group of the same name stopped. That name sort of stuck. I'm still getting requests for renaming because it's so bloody hard to pronounce. And it starts with a K, so it's ugly. Krita, I don't think it's that hard, and it even makes a good verb, right? I'm going to totally critter this image. I don't know why I don't hear that, but I still hear people talking about photoshopping an image. Back in those days, the Q3 days, when we were finally working on a release of Krita, the project was almost dead, and that's quite a common occurrence, because you start enthusiastically with your free software project, and then you realize that, oh my god, it's going to be so much work. It's going to be so much more work than I'd ever imagined. I'm going to stop. Actually, that happened to me as well. In 2003, I got a graphics tablet for my birthday because I wanted to draw a map for a fantasy novel I was writing. And I was trying to do that with GIMP, and I didn't understand GIMP. That's my fault, not GIMP's fault. So I started my own painting application in Python and Qt because I'd written a book about Python and Qt. And after 2 months, I realized that I totally didn't have a clue. I could write an application that would show a canvas, it would show a menu bar, a toolbar, a status bar, and it couldn't draw a line. So I had to look for some project that would make a good start for me. At that point, Krita had 3 rewrites of its internals in 6 years. It hadn't had a release. It had 3 renames, 3 rewrites. It could load an image, it could show an image, but it could not draw a line. And it was written in C++, which I didn't know. It was written in Qt, which I did know, because of PyQt. So I started working on it, and by then I sort of didn't mind admitting my ignorance. So I started blogging about it. Look, I can make a red square, and if I press really hard with my stylus on my tablet, the red square gets bigger. That was quite something. A little later, I was blogging, I can make a line, but the lines are horrible. They are getting bended. It's like this. If you're making a drawing application, what you're actually doing is you draw footsteps of your brush with my right hand. And if you make enough of those, you will get a line. However, drawing those steps can be quite time-consuming. So if with my first painting tool in Krita, you wanted to draw, say, a circle, it would look like this. Because the system would drop all events between in here and it couldn't interpolate. And that's something that every painting application was struggling with. So what I did was, I blogged about it. I'm trying three different ways of making a nice round circle in Krita when drawing with freehand. And I'm not succeeding. What am I doing wrong? What happened is that suddenly we had four more contributors. There was this guy from England, Adrian Page, and he took my line drawing code and fixed it. There was this guy from Denmark, and he took the rendering code and rewrote it. And there was this guy from Germany, and he started implementing some of the dockers. And there was this guy from France, and he started implementing filters. And I was like, this is fun. And we had a lot of fun. We finally made a release. The guy from Denmark called me a slave driver, and he was right. Because we were going for this release, and it was going to be the first release. After years of work, just when we were going into beta, one day before we released the beta, we had this new backend rewritten. That was the fourth time we rewrote the backend. And finally we had infinite layers. Because there are two kinds of painting applications. One where every layer has a fixed size, and if you move the layer, you still can draw outside it. And the other one is where you can draw outside the original size of the layer. Krita started out as a Gimp clone, so it was the first kind. And then we rewrote it to be the second kind. Release Krita 1.4. We got reviews in the Linux press, because this was still old days, 2004, 2005, when the Linux desktop was hot and we were still trying to create a complete replacement for a proprietary system. That's something that actually, for me, changed in a way, because I'm not trying to totally replace an application on another application. I'm trying to make something that it's its own thing. So, but in those days, we were going to do everything that Photoshop could do, and we were going to do it on Linux, and we were going to do it integrated with KDE. That was Krita 1.4. It got reviewed. The reviews were really positive. Because it was a new application and it could do some stuff nothing else could do. And then we released Krita 1.5, which had CMYK support, which is, and at least in the way we implemented it back then, totally useless for actual users. Digital artists don't paint in CMYK. They paint in RGB and convert to CMYK, clean up, and then publish. We didn't support that. But we had this tick box, CMYK, OpenGL Canvas, filter layers, non-destructive editing. We were complete, except that we still didn't have users. And we didn't understand why we didn't have users. So we just went on. We started working on Krita 1.6, and at the same time we started porting to Qt 4. By the time we released Krita 1.6, we had a user. He was a guy from Finland, and he did some really nice work in Krita 1.6, and he had some really, really interesting comments about usability and performance and stability especially. And he said, if it doesn't get any more stable, I really will have to stop using it. In that case, you can either say, okay, stop using it, and start using something else or start listening. This was more or less when we were beginning to realize that what we were doing was not developing software. We were not developing an application. We were having fun writing code. The code mostly compiled, and if you would start the application, something would happen, but it was not an application for users. And in my opinion, an application that's not written for users is like the sound a tree makes when nobody is listening. It's screaming in space. It's just not useful. But at that time, we were also having other problems. The port to Qt 4 was horrible. We are currently porting to Qt 5, and that's also horrible, but not as horrible as the port to Qt 4 was. That was really horrible, because we were really dumb. We were doing a complete rewrite of Krita, and the other applications in the suite, a complete re-architecturing during a port. That's the most crazy thing you can do. Don't do that. We did it. It took years before we arrived at Krita 2.0, which sucked. You could not make a selection and cut pixels. Krita 2.1 sucked as well. It sucked a little less, but only a little less, and it was totally unusable. 2.2 was just as bad. And that was the moment when a French guy, David Rivois, he started moving from proprietary software to free software. He is an idealist, and he wanted to do this because he'd noticed that when he bought a new computer, which came with a new version of Windows, he needed a new license for all of his drawing software. And at that time, he was the proud owner of Photoshop, Corel Painter, and a bunch of other applications. And he just couldn't afford replacing all of them. So he said to himself, I'm going to check what this free software community is giving us. And it gave him the software that he could use professionally to do his work. Not without limitations, not without loss of productivity, but using Gimp and MyPaint, he could do his job. And we just had decided, as creative developers, that we couldn't be everything to everyone. We were not going to do a complete Photoshop clone. We were going to do an application for painters, for illustrators, for comic book artists, for metal painters, texture painters. So we were doing an application that was free software, and that was targeted at this guy, and he could not use our application. What do you do if that happens? If you learn that your application is so bad that your target audience cannot use it? Well, you can stop coding, or you can start coding even more. That's where we figured out that we wanted to continue. We had this vision. We are going to make a really great painting application for real artists all over the world. That takes time, more time than we actually had as spare time developers. A bunch of Summer of Code students, 3 months of focused work on improving performance, but some things just take a whole lot of time. At this point, Lukas Trudy, he is from Slovakia, he was almost finished university, and he had a couple of months of spare time, which in his country apparently is being used to earn some money before you start writing a thesis. He was also going to do a thesis on Krita brush engines, but he had this spare time and he wanted to earn money. Totally fair. Guy has to eat. He has to pay rent for his apartment. If I remember correctly, his apartment went for 90 euros a month, and he was worried that we could not collect enough money to help him pay for his apartment. We did our first fundraiser. It was quite a primitive affair. I took all the money in my own bank account, which is not a good idea, and makes for really horrible administration headaches. But we got the money, and we paid Lukas, and Lukas spent months and months and months fixing all those bugs, all that instability, all those performance issues. And then we released Krita 2.3, and David Rivois said, this is a very nice illustration application. It has potential. It's not suitable for professional use because the workflow sucks, but you guys, you have made a nice application for amateurs to use. Say, if they want to paint some manga. Okay. We improved. Not enough, but we did improve. So, I shouldn't do that. I'm used to talking with my hands. We were happy. We had proven two things. Krita was improving, and funding development does not kill your project. Because that was a huge worry back then. I remember discussions on the KDEV mailing list about how funding destroyed some KDE projects, and fears that that would happen with Krita as well. The idea being, if you're a volunteer developer and you're having fun hacking, and someone else is getting paid for hacking, then you will feel bad because you're not getting any money. That's totally logical, but apparently it's a fallacy because it didn't work out that way. We got more money than we knew what to do with, actually, because there was this well-off guy who liked Lucas' work so much that he sponsored Lucas for another period. This full-time work really made a difference because it takes the application to another level. So when we released Krita 2.4, David Rivoire switched. We had reached our goal, make David happy. And we knew that by now Krita was good enough for other people. Linux using illustrators all over the world now could use Krita to paint. That was a huge success. And then several things happened together. I started a company together with Inge Wallin, who is also a KDE member, and another guy. And Dimitri was finishing at university, and I didn't want to lose his contributions. So we started looking into ways of accelerating even more. And the thing is it's a lot like running. Running is a controlled form of falling. If you go faster, you won't fall. So we have been going faster and faster ever since. So if Krita is good on Linux, why shouldn't Krita be good on Windows either? Turns out that porting a KDE application to Windows, if you've got a target of having 1 million downloads, is hard. The KDE 4 libraries were not suitable for releasing software on Windows. I had to strip them down a lot, remove things like Dbus, because people with oversensitive virus scanners got really frightened about Dbus. Fortunately, we managed to get some funding. Intel funded our first effort of porting the whole Calligra suite to Windows, and in its wake it funded creating a special tablet version of Krita and then a two-in-one version of Krita called Krita Gemini, which meant that with this support we managed to release a good application on Windows. That took more than a year of full-time work, which is not cheap. And we really needed that. The thing is, now that we're on Windows, we're getting about 30,000 downloads a month. And that's about 1,000 times what I see happening with increase in Linux users. So that means a huge new pool of people who can join the community. And I'm really happy to say that by now we have actually got a Windows-only developer, a guy who only uses Windows. No, I'm wrong. We've got two. They're both trying to fix the same bug on the Surface Pro with a stylus. Okay, I'm fine. With this huge growth comes a community, and community is an overused word. What is a community? It's not just the developers. I consider everyone who uses Krita to be part of the family, and I try to foster that feeling among the community using social media, of course, but also something really simple. If someone reports a bug for Krita, I say thank you for your report. I noticed that almost no developer does that, but it's amazingly powerful, because once you've said to this guy who comes to a bugzilla and has taken the effort to register the bug and maybe even make a video of the bug, and even if I can't reproduce it, which happens quite often, of course, and then he's like, oh my god, Krita ate my data and it's my image and it totally sucks. Oh, and what am I going to do now? I say, thank you for your report. I'm sorry about your data loss. I will try to help you recover your file if the file is broken. But if you say thank you, you've diffused that tense situation. And that's just one of the things where you can improve your interaction with your users and avoid all those nasty flame fests that happen all too often. Of course, now that Krita is getting really popular, I'm also getting really weird reports and really weird mails. Albert Asselseed, who doesn't do anything on Krita, a guy who was working on Kexi, Adam Pick, and I both got the same mail. Well, Albert got a tweet, Adam got a mail, and I got a forum message with the same text. Hi, I want to do custom development on Krita. I have $150. So I finally managed to contact the guy, and what he wants is relicense Krita to a commercial closed proprietary license, add a license manager, rename the application, rebrand it totally, make sure that there's an undo button in the toolbar, and the selection outline is no longer marching ends but a solid line, and he wants to pay me $150 for that. I'm doing a lot for money. I really like money. Every cent that the Creative Foundation gets helps fund development, sprints, fun stuff. But I'm not doing that. So how am I funding creative development? Creative development currently is funded in a lot of different ways. And I'm going to tell you my dirty secret. I copy everything Ton Roosendaal does for the Blender Foundation. He is making a free software product that can afford to pay a dozen developers. And that's just awesome. So what I'm doing is we are selling DVDs, training DVDs. We've currently got two DVDs, and there's a third one coming up, at least going to be created, called Secrets of Krita. And it's going to be really exciting. We are selling... Yeah, the guy grinning over there, he's going to make it. That's an investment, of course, but you get it back. We are still selling about a dozen of the Muses DVDs a month. We are selling Krita on Steam. The advantage for the people who get Krita on Windows on Steam is they get automatic updates. There's also a version. They also get the Gemini version, but it's a bit of a problem because that version is broken. So the latest version of Krita doesn't have the Gemini bits, but they also get the latest version of Krita. Automatic updates, integration with the Steam cloud thingy. That's bringing in money, about between 500 and 1,000 euros a month, which is amazing. We've got a Krita development fund where people can subscribe and give us a monthly donation. That works out well. We are getting lots of individual donations as well. People who use Krita and decide, okay, I made my deadline, I earned some money, I'm going to give you guys some money. And then, of course, the Kickstarter campaigns that everyone knows about, because we are really public about those. The last one was a big success, and I'm actually considering doing a second one this year for OSX development, because I'm estimating that we have Krita on OSX, but it sucks. It's not suitable for professional use. It will take me at least four months of full-time work, really nasty work that nobody wants to do for free, to get there. Right now, I make those OSX builds just to make sure it stays buildable. So what the point where I'm trying to get to is, As a free software community, the free software community that KDE is, sometimes lives in a bit of a bubble. We read free software blogs, free software websites, Linux websites, and we keep up with all that news. But there is such a big world outside. that's what made me so incredibly happy when we got a review in ImagineFX. It's a paper magazine, those still exist, for artists, mostly digital artists, some traditional artists who paint fantasy images. Now, there's this whole cultural upbringing thing that I had to sort of shake off. When I was 17, and needed to leave high school and go to university, I was sort of, well, I can go to university, or I can go to an art school and do something with my sculpture. But if you become an artist, you are going to starve, right? Art is frivolous, doesn't bring in money, and there are way too many people doing art anyway. So, go to university and do something useful like studying the languages of the hill tribes of Eastern Nepal. Which are really fun languages. So, lots of interesting features. I don't regret my choice. But when I started working on Krita, I still had the same attitude. Art is frivolous. It's a fun bit. The serious parts of K-Office were, of course, the word processor and the spreadsheet, because those are serious applications for serious people earning serious money. Well, artists are earning serious money. I don't know how many artists are being employed by the Game of Thrones, television series, but it must be a lot. And all of them should use Krita for their concept art, of course. Same goes for all those Hollywood movies. And I happen to know that for some of those Hollywood movies, Krita has been used, both for concept art and for creating the matte paintings, those painted backgrounds. If you watch a movie, check whether the clouds move. If the clouds don't move, it's a painting. And there are a lot of them, because it's way too expensive to model a whole world in 3D or to go on location. So, for instance, for that Disney movie about the big white guy, I've forgotten the title actually because I haven't seen it. Little Big Hero, that's it. Krita was used for G.I. Joe. And I'm actively trying to get Krita used by more studios, which is a hard task. You would think it would be easy because a movie studio, a VFX studio, a game studio, they are mostly using Linux. They are using CentOS because they are too cheap to pay for Red Hat. They are using the Linux applications from Autodesk, and Autodesk is, as far as I know, too cheap to pay for the Qt license. All those applications are using Qt. An application like Mari, which is a 3D painting application, uses PySight because they are too cheap to pay for PyQt. So there is this, and that's probably the reason they are not paying for Krita yet. They really want an application like Krita, a 2D painting application that runs on Linux and is fast enough and has all the features they need. So I'm pushing in that area as well. And then some unexpected things happened, like last year, the first book on Krita was published in Japanese. I was already going to order it when the publisher sent me a copy. It's got lots of cute manga girls in it. So I hinted in the talk description for the program that I was going to talk a bit about plans, and I've got 22 seconds, so that's going to work. We are going to maintain the Qt 4 version until the end of the year, doing monthly releases with features. We are working on animation support, a Summer of Code project, but it's also something that the foundation is funding. I'm working on the Qt 5 port. I'm struggling with the OpenGL part. I'm getting black screens and nothing but black screens, and I don't know why yet. But Krita actually uses some weird OpenGL stuff, like GL FenSync, which apparently nobody else uses. I don't know. I can't get it to work. Okay, well, I can show you the code.
And then I didn't write that one.
At least one Kickstarter per year, maybe two, because OSX is a special case. OSX users don't want to pay for the general Kickstarter because they can't use the result anyway, and they are right. We're going to do the DVD, and there's going to be a book published in English. It's written already, it's in the editing phase, and there's a publisher. And then next year, well, I guess we will try to do even more. Thank you. We're still packaging way too much stuff.
What do you use DBS for?
We don't.
Oh, okay.
They cut it out, and that still works.
The thing about DBS is, well, on Linux we've got this default DBS interface you can use to create new windows, open files, or stuff like that. That's a straight port of the decop stuff we had from K-Office 1 or something, right?
K-Application, so if you port away from K-Application, that's done anyway.
Yeah, we are doing that. So, but on Windows, apparently that triggers alarms. With some users. The thing is, if you're deploying a Windows application to a corporate environment, you can do stuff like that. If you're making a Windows application available for download for Windows users all over the world, anything that opens a socket is going to be a problem. I don't know why, but it's true.
No, but I understand that, but if you don't need it, then I don't get the issue why you have it. All we need is kind of a build without diverse options.
Yes,
no.
Yes,
no,
but
right.
KDNX 4.
Oh, yeah, come that's there now, right?
No, I support it until the end of the year. At least I need it until the end of the year. And I don't know about frameworks can be completely built without diverse, I don't know yet.
Well, you might have to skip a few frameworks, so the whole question is whether you need them.
Yeah, right now we need even KDNX 4 support, because we haven't been able to cut out all of that yet.
Sure.
First, I want to fix the OpenGL canvas. Then we should be more or less feature parity between 2.9 and the framework support. And now we can start debugging, because there are lots of weird little issues that are probably caused by weird code inside Krita. And then we will start stripping and cleaning and refactoring. But we are not going to do a refactor before the port is complete.
So probably getting rid of K-Service would resolve most of the DBA stuff, because K-Service, K-Builds and Cooker triggering goes into K-Database, right? So that's
actually, the Q4 version of Krita already doesn't use K-Builds and Cooker anymore. It was not supportable in OS X. At least not without making the user do weird stuff. On OS X, the user opens a disk image, grabs the application to the application folder, clicks it, and wants to start painting. And any extra step is a step too much. I wish I could figure out a way to make it as easy to install Krita on Linux as well. And actually, a Norwegian guy is working on that.
Well, for installing it easily, you can make it a portable application, which easy installs on Windows are called portable applications, and they're just a folder which you unpack. There's a version of that for Firefox and also for LibreOffice, so you can probably learn something from those guys.
Yeah, we've got that for Windows.
Oh, okay, sorry.
But we haven't got it for Linux yet. And of course, that means that I'm maintaining the CentOS port of Krita which is something you really don't want to do, because that's Qt 4.6. And that means a lot of workarounds. Dimitri maintains the Ubuntu PPA. There's a guy keeping Arch up to date. Dan Lanier maintains the OBS build for OpenSUSE. But I'd really like just one installer, a .run file that people download, just like they have with Blender. Because like I said, I try to copy Blender. I copy what Tom does for two reasons, because it works for Tom and because my target user group is used to it, because they're used to what Blender does. That's also why I love Fabricator.
Alright, last question, I guess.
So I'm a little bit surprised that you have your own PDA. I mean, we have a really good relationship to Kubernetes devs, similar to your user. I mean, they should be able to provide that for you.
The main issue there, we actually started out using the Project Neon stuff to make this PPA. The main issue is the LTS releases. For what I understand, and correct me if I'm wrong, wouldn't be the first time, using the regular Kubuntu backports PPA, you won't get a backport to the last LTS. And artists are weird people, they like stability a lot and they want the latest features as well. So they want to have the long-term support version of Ubuntu, that's fine for them. And they want to have the latest Krita. It's actually amazing how many of these artists are using... let me see, has this got a web browser? Can the owner of this laptop please help me? It's amazing how many artists build Krita from source every morning. They get up, build Krita, brush their teeth, take breakfast, have coffee, start doodling. I want a web browser.
Ah, yes.
And then just search for Krita cat guide, as in pussycat. No, not for guide, cat.
Oh.
Yeah. Building Krita on Linux for cats. And then... I'll scroll down a bit. This was done by David Rivoire. He first had a set of scripts that would build Krita, and then he decided that doesn't work. I'm going to teach people to use Krita. And he illustrated it. Can I scroll? No, that doesn't work.
Scroll,
click.
Ah, just scroll, please. It, I mean, isn't that cute? And then more illustrations.
Oh, it's rigorous.
How to build, how to get your source code from Git, how to get the right Git branch, configure, install, building. There is your beautiful new Krita. Make sure it can run. Be happy. I'm really left-handed. And then we developers create an awesome new feature. We do that all the time. our monthly releases are feature-packed. So he wants to have the new version. And is happy. But sometimes we break stuff. We do that all the time as well. So he has to figure out, poor cat, which is the last revision that actually worked, and go back. And he's happy again.
Yeah. So, thank you so much for this great short history of Krita. I hope it keeps going and going, growing and going stronger. Thank you.
Thank you.